we have to do much more detail of simulation of the effect of social policy. Like you know that when you introduce the social protection, first they have the direct effect to the poverty and inequality. You push money in to any household, at least they will get them better income or decrease their expenditure. And suddenly, it decreases inequity and poverty. You can see this quite clear because it's direct effect. And you can simulate. Either you use the... If you target for a specific group of people like children, elderly, or the poor, you can simulate that how many household will get that benefit. And then you can see that you decrease the poverty. And finally, it will affect to something that more than just only the effect of that household. In terms of economic, we call that as a spillover or multiplier effect. Means that like something that you can get something more advantage or disadvantage, it depends on something. Yeah. For example, very simple, like sometimes you provide money to a household, then they have more debt, more income. The effect spillover maybe go to next step, like some supermarket or restaurant or other people that they can gain benefit. And it's like a multiplier that you will what you put one currency unit, but for the economic performance, maybe you get more than one. We call this a multiplier effect, right? But for the social protection, it just not only the direct effect. They also have indirect effect, and that is much more stronger in terms of technical term we call it behavioral effect. Like when you put something into social protection like education, like healthcare, or child well-being, or other type labor policy. For education, what you get is increased human capital, right? If they are just only Ivy school education, you can expect that their income is pretty low. If you have more and more people who get a bachelor degree or more than that, you can expect that income may be 20 times more than they just finish the primary school. This is effect of the they will increase human capital, right? And this human capital that increase what we call the labor productivity. Now it's a real remote labor productivity, not that just the one that we just calculate, right? Here also the same. If you can provide a better health setup for people, they work more and spend less on their health problem, something like that. Then your human capital increase and it affect to the labor productivity too. Okay? Child well-being also. They can learn smart, more, something like that. Or if you invest on some infrastructure or some kind of the condition transfer that machine, they have the new equipment for their production, then this also lead to the labor productivity. So you can simulate this. How can we get this? We see from history, like you have every country have the labor force survey, have a social economic survey, have a health survey, welfare survey, something like that. We can do something like cross section and see the effect from time to time. If you have a series of 1 and 10 years, you can see the different effect of people who are in primary school compared to if they graduate secondary school or bachelor degree, something like that, how far they gain more, something like that. And then you put it into the Simon-Sinek equation like this. Finally, you can get how much money you create more of the economic performance. And so you spend here and you get here. Okay. Employment is here because when you have more human capital, it depends on the detail of your model. You can assume it, or you can separate equation or something like that. Let the economists do this, but this is the way that we do. Like, you can see that okay, they increase the productivity, then you can separate the different employment and simulate more for if you would like to take effect of employment into this. Maybe the increase or maybe decrease, it depends on the situation that you can be. It's like a what-if analysis. If you have full employment, what happens? If you have like a 10% unemployment, what happens? Something like that. You mean employment? Okay. Yes. This time again, I'm not sure. Yeah. When we say about employment, it means that they can create some money, right?
Some job.
Yeah, and also they also spending.
Yes.
So as I said before in the previous section that we can see the GDP in many different ways, in the production way. As we said that they produce something, we can collect it in the monetary term, and when they have money, they spend. We can also calculate the GDP on the expenditure side. Or if they have more income, we can calculate GDP on the income side. But by this three ways, you can get the same figure in theory. Yeah. So every economic sector, they have three components. You can see it in the expenditure side or income side or production side. It depends on the way you design detail of equation. Yeah, but you just really not confused, because if you conflict it on the expenditure side, you have to follow that. For income side, you have to follow that. Otherwise, your equation will conflict with each other. So finally, you can compare how much money you put in and what is your return in the future. Yeah. Okay. And this economic performance also contribute to social protection too, because when people have more money, then you can collect more money to the social protection, something like that. Okay, this is like a theoretical framework. You can do it in much more detail. Okay. And this is one that Dr. Pasitra Gosman just finished from the Cambodia. Cambodia just only implement a few one, only a few social protection. And what she calculated from the 2 series of social economic survey in Cambodia, she found that social protection in Cambodia, current one, will create around 11 to 14% return from this investment. Explain that. You can
yield of 20 years?
Yeah.
14% divided by 20.
Yeah, by but in 20 years. But if you compare with something like a rapid return, or you create a dam, or any capital investment, the infrastructure one, the return is quite similar. If not, you have to put a lot here. First, you build the building, build the infrastructure like a train or road or something like that, and the return is steady like this. So in the conclusion is that the social protection is one kind of investment. It's not the just only expenditure. So, but it is like a capital investment, not the short run that you invest this year, you will get this year. You invest in children, you will return it in next 10 years, 20 years. You put something in the healthcare, you will return 5 years, 10 years, something like that. So, combination of all, if every country may be different, and if you input in different things, the return it may be different. And the combination of more than one social protection policy, you have much more effect than just only addition. You have some multiplier effect too. So this is only the real example how can be calculated for the return if the Mr. Finance argue about why we have to invest a lot. And I think any country understand this. But sometimes we have to like to show clearly whether it's better than invest on the rapid train, something like that. Because the government have very limited budget. So it's the one way that you can show that although we invest a lot now, but the gain future, we gain a lot too, something like that. Similar to when the people or the they decide to, or the government decide to build a high speed train or other kind of infrastructure, they also have to think the same thing. Because for the capital investment, they put a lot at the first time.
So this study is based on historical or
projection? Projection. But you know,
the year is, say, from now, zero is now and then?
Yeah, usually the way to do some kind of this simulation is that you need to know the growth. That's why you need like a more than one series of history that what is the growth or different of certain specific group that you interest. Like if you for example in Cambodia they use two socioeconomic survey to calculate for the difference of the income of the children. And at the time they are children, but now they are working age group. How much they change of the income, something like that.
Is there a study but looking at
historical? Yeah, it's history, but you can forecast. The same thing, you have to analyze the historical data. And then you, similar to what we forecast for the GDP. Mm-hmm. You have to understand the growth and something like that. The safety of this projection is it show you that because if you just analyze for the past, it just only the call it evaluation research. But if you use anything but put some assumption in and looking into the specific impact, then you can get the, some kind of a result like this.
Yeah, what does the broken line graphical
is big break even, right? Break even point.
The break even point.
Yeah, it means that before this you have to wait, and then you get the return more and more until it equal to your investment. It's similar to if you read in the business textbook or the financial textbook, they use the same concept. You have to invest first, and then your return is steady.
In the case of Cambodia, after 20 years, they
become a breaking point. Yeah, by this, if you believe in her assumption.
Yes, yes, of course. And then it indicates that 40.7.
Yeah.
In a matter of.
I'm not sure, but definitely her assumption. Because it depends on the type of investment too. Some of you can gain a lot. For example, if you invest on education, maybe different from investment on the pension or different on investment on many benefit package. So but usually it's something like that, if you have something in your stock, maybe you don't invest much, just be like a marginal effort and you can get